5,000 years ago, and we have not known one day of peace. This is a fact. So, in coming to try to understand life somehow, and understand the mechanics of how a country like Israel can survive such a rough neighborhood around it, there must be some historic perspective. There must be some understanding that there is not here some problem that went wrong in the Middle East and we just need to fix it somehow. This is our instinct as Jews to believe that everything can be fixed and everything will be all right. Our people stood in lines to the gas chambers and still believe that everything will be all right. It's our Jewish genes, and you know what? Maybe it's better to be this way than to be in another way. But it has a very high price of being naive and irrational. I think of myself as belonging to the peace camp in Israel. Those that peace in our lifetime, to them, is the most important thing. And one thing I'm sure of is that the desire for peace does not come out of your opinion on how to reach it. We are a united people in our desire for peace, on how we think we should get there. I have not met yet one Israeli who would not give everything he has for peace. Unfortunately, that desire has left us confused, weak, and convoluted in political correctness that is going to make peace even more and more remote from us. And in the core of that culture is what the mentality that has evolved in the last century that is called land for peace. The thought that by us, the Jews, the leadership of the Jewish people back in the early 1900s, and today the state of Israel, can buy peace by throwing territorial assets at the enemy. Just like chips you have, and if you throw a $20 chip, it didn't help. You throw a $50 chip, and that won't help. Well, let's throw a $200 chip, maybe that will help. And we have done it repeatedly, and it always failed. A matter of fact, not only it failed, in several cases, land for peace was the cause for the next war.
That's right.
Exactly the cause for the next war. And I think that if we want to improve a little bit our life, we have to start doing business in a different way. I believe that Israel today is stronger than ever before. Israel, in general, its situation is better than 30 years ago, is better than 60 years ago. The well-being of the Jews is maybe at its best ever. What are we afraid of all the time? What is this confusion? And I think that if we want to have peace with our Arab neighbors, and if we understand how strategically key it is to take Israel to the next level, then we cannot do more of the same, because it is going to fail again also.
Amen.
And look at the human nature. We tried with the Alone program back in the 70s. It evolved into the Jordanian program in the 80s. Then that didn't work, so we went to the Oslo agreements. Rabin and Clinton took the most successful career terrorist that ever lived,
ooh,
Yasser Arafat,
yeesh,
and built him an army of terrorists inside the boundaries of the state of Israel, while he is promising to use this army against us, gave him a Nobel Peace Prize for 50 years of murdering children and women and innocent people around the world. More Americans than Israelis, by the way, were killed by the PLO over the years. And while the Israeli intelligence and the Israeli society and people who understand came to Rabin and begged him, don't do it. It will fail. He went on. And against the majority of the people in Israel, including everything that followed, coloring people like me, propellers and enemies of peace and all sorts of nonsense like that. And we saw the result. 10 years of unprecedented bloodshed in Israel, directly because of a man-made effort, a genuine effort to earn peace. I don't suspect Rabin of any bad intentions for Israel. Of course, he believed it, but that was his mistake. It was also Sharon's belief that if Israel will pull out of Gaza, then it will earn Israel more maneuvering on the international arena, more understanding, and show the Palestinians some goodwill. It's very tragic that Rabin did not live to see the results of the Oslo agreements. And it's very tragic that Ariel Sharon did not, well, he's of course still alive, but unfortunately is in a very deep coma. And he did not see the results of his pullout of Gaza just last January. I live near Ashdod. I've never heard a siren in my life in my area since the Yom Kippur War in 1973. And this last January, I spent 30 days running in and out of a bomb shelter because of missiles fired on my house from the Gaza Strip. And this is a direct result of a man-made mistake of pulling out of Gaza, pulling out of the Philadelphia route, allowing Egypt and the Hamas to decide how much arms are going to flow in those underground tunnels that nobody's doing anything to stop. And look at the fascinating Jewish nature of trying to look at all this and say, so what do we do now? Of course, let's have two states. That's the $200 chip. Well, since the $10 chip failed and the $50 chip failed, let's give everything we've got. That will, of course, bring peace instantly.
Yeah.
Hamas, the Islamic Jihad, the Hezbollah. By the way, the Iranians also will stop making an atomic bomb if we take the Palestinians there.
Right. Right.
The Saudis will have peace with us immediately. All we need to do is give Jerusalem to the PLO there, or the Palestinian Authority that is still teaching children in kindergarten how to activate waste bomb straps. I wonder how many people who are preaching me about land for peace, about Palestinian statehood, how many of them read one book that has been published by the Palestinian Authority? One book, really read it, really read what they say about Haifa, about Tel Aviv. Nobody. Because when you read what the Palestinians say about Haifa, you will not believe that giving them Palestinian statehood is going to change anything. And all of this is happening because of a spiritual collapse of ours. I don't belong to those Israelis who sit all day and whine about the world.